our speaker Brad Cairns registered his first woodworking company at the age of 16. In his own words, "There was just no other path for me. I love to build stuff." After 25 years in the business, he brings a vast knowledge of woodworking to the industry. His personal BHAG, Big Hairy Audacious Goals, is to transform the woodworking industry back into a fun and profitable sector of North American manufacturing. As an avid student of TPS, Toyota Production Systems, and TOC, Theory of Constraints, these combined manufacturing principles are the basis of his approach to business. Brad makes lean thinking fun and easy for everyone to understand and participate. So everyone, please give a warm welcome to Brad, our next presenter.
Thank you. Oh, thank you. Thank you. So welcome, everybody. I can't tell you how much I appreciate all of you taking your time out of this busy show to come here and listen to me yap at you for 30 minutes. What this is going to be a whole lot like drinking from a fire hose. I have 30 minutes. If you know me, if you've been to my booth, you know 30 minutes is a walk in the park for talking. So I am going to fire hose feed you five things that you need to do right now to get your lean journey going. And we'll get this started. So are we ready to get going with some lean manufacturing? Yeah. That's what I'm talking about. I want everybody around here to go, what the heck is going on over there? All right, so who wants to grow their business? Show of hands. Not you. Yeah, I know you do. I talked to you for like 3 hours today. Sorry, keep them up. Who wants to grow their business? Okay, everybody, almost everybody, good. Going to give you a little piece of advice I got when I was studying in Japan. I didn't believe it at the time, but hopefully by the time our 30 minutes is up, you believe it because I believe it now. It's so freaking easy. You have one thing to do and one thing only. Grow your people. That's it. It's not going to be the next widget maker. It's not going to be whatever. It is growing your people is the answer. So the question is, if you want your business to grow and you have a whole bunch of people making maybe not the best decisions, you can't be everywhere every time making every improvement. So how do we turn all of your employees into change agents that are making improvements for your business? This is growing people. When they're making better decisions, they're not only making better decisions at your factory, they're making better decisions at home, which actually helps them come to work a little more often. So growing people, 100% the key. How do we do it? You got all of these tools and techniques. When you talk about lean, you'll hear all of the buzzwords. They're probably all appearing. Here we go. And it's just like, oh my God, where do I even begin this lean thing? What is this lean thing? Where do I begin? And you go from like panicking, like, ah, I have all these tools and things to choose from, and I'm seeing all this stuff on YouTube and the internet. And you go from crazy excited to probably like, forget about it, too much work. And you just end up doing nothing. There's a phrase for that. Analysis paralysis. We're trying to figure out what's the right thing to do. Where do I get started? And you end up just spinning your tires or sleeping on logs if you're a big cat. So before I leave today, we want five things that I want you to write down and start those five things as soon as humanly possible. And I promise nothing but good things are gonna happen. Are we ready for five things?
Yeah.
There we go. So what we're going to try and do, I'm a big fan of Pareto's law. So 80-20, it really pans out. So to say we're going to solve all of your problems, it's not going to happen. You're going to have problems forever. We're manufacturing. The only thing I know for sure is factories deliver problems day in and day out. I have three of them. I know. So what we're going to do is we're going to tackle 80% of your problems. We're going to help you try and get rid of that right here today, getting started. Keeping in mind, what we're talking about today is fast. I won't have time to explain it all if you want to not be here for 3 days. It's the tip of the iceberg. This is the tip of the lean iceberg. I'm just trying to get you curious and a little shove in the right direction. There is immense depth to lean, immense depth. So how do we get started? Two principles. One is easier, better, faster, cheaper. This was coined phrased by, I think it was Taichi Ono, creator of the Toyota Production System. He said, easier, better, faster, cheaper, in that order. So how we normally do it as people, we think, okay, I want to grow my business. I need to edge out my competitor. I need to just be a little bit. This would be fun if you guys read it out when I pointed it out, right? Cheaper. Yeah, okay. And then we're like, okay, so how do we make things cheaper? Then we absolutely have to go and make things faster. Then say you have the best team in the world and everybody's 100% engaged. And they're like, yeah, let's make it cheaper. Yeah, I'm going to make it faster. Now, has anyone given this directive in their factory and said, everyone go work faster? What happens? Nothing good, ever. So when we talk about better, our quality starts going down, and fast. And usually you get to build things twice, which is not the ideal situation. And then when you go to the shop floor and you ask people, hey, since our new directive to get that market share and work faster, has your job got any easier? There's not a person in your factory that will be like, yeah, man, that was awesome. We all just started working at 3 times the speed and it got so easy. So this is how we all think normally. This is how we want to think. So I'm going to propose something different today. I'm going to propose that if you're in a leadership position, your only job is to support the people on the shop floor and ask them, how can I make your job easier? They're the only ones that know, and they will tell you. As a matter of fact, the problem you will have is shutting them up at that point because they have so many ideas you won't even believe it, but nobody's asked them before. And you're going to say, I want to make your job easier. They give you the ideas. You start implementing them. Small, incremental things. We're not talking about rearranging the whole shop. We're talking about 2-second improvements. So say you're successful and you make someone's job easier to the point of they save 10 minutes a day. Okay, good improvement. Now I'm finishing that laminate table and I look and the edge has that scratch on it right before we're shipping it. And you do the, oh, I'm gonna rub that scratch out and hope that no one sees it and we're shipping poor quality. Or this guy now has an extra 10 minutes. He's not under the gun trying to work faster, more likely to take the time, take the 10 minutes, fix the defect, put the quality into the product and ship it to your customer. Done deal. So by making their job easier, our quality starts to go up. Once our quality goes up and we stop making things twice, now I'm sure no one's factory here has any defects, correct? Just mine. Okay, I'll speak from my experience. My factory makes a lot of defects and we have to fix them. So when the quality starts going up, we stop having to make things twice. Everybody has a little more time, and you're talking making things better from engineering all the way through to installation. So everyone's saving themselves that time. Everyone's building in that little bit more quality each day. We stop the rework, we stop building things twice, and therefore now we're building them faster. At this point, your customers will be so thrilled with you, they won't really mind the price. They're already paying it. But if you so choose, now we talk about price. So focus on making your people's job easier. Don't worry about the rest. Here's the magic. If we start on this side and we focus on, what is this symbolizing first? Money, right? We're thinking about money first. So we think about money first, and then we go this way, and we have to have meetings and rally the troops and fight through quality control, and no one's job is getting easier. This is an uphill battle. We focus on making everyone's job easier. Quality goes up inherently. Quality goes up, we start making things faster. We start making things faster, we can offer them cheaper. Zero intervention from here down. Zero. It just happens automatically. So here's the magic. This, we're thinking about money first. What are we thinking about here first? People. So think about the people first, make their job easier, better, faster, cheaper. Combine this philosophy with fix what bugs you, because this is now going to tie into this. We want to fix the things that bug us. I mean, you can read a million books. You can do whatever you want. You should, as a matter of fact. But everybody has a lean genius built in. It's simple. Every time we turn around and we're like, ah, that sucks. Oh, I dropped my pencil again. Oh, why isn't the paperwork right? This is our inside lean genius saying, hey, this bugs me. let's fix it. So when someone comes over and says, I want to make your job easier, you just take the last thing that you went like crap and done, fix what bugs you. So this is the winning combination for escalating your people, teaching them how to see waste, fixing what bugs them, and then the business starts to do better. So this is the overriding principle that we're talking about today. Does that make sense? Okay. We will keep going. Yeah, I already covered all that. Step one, pens, pencils, markers, pictures, whatever you got to do. Read this book if you haven't already. 2 Second Lean, my buddy Paul Akers wrote this book. He takes lean and makes it so simple, it's unbelievable. Everything we teach comes from the Toyota production system and what Paul has done in 2 Second Lean. He set the bar so low for improvements that no one cannot make an improvement every day. And it's magic. It's like putting 2 cents in the bank. It seems pointless at the time, but compound interest over a couple of years, and those improvements just add up and add up and add up. So quick story, at my factory, we don't work for 1 hour a day. Imagine shutting all your factories down for 1 hour a day and having every single employee making improvements. That's what we do. That's how powerful it is for us. So we spend 30 minutes on the factory and we spend 30 minutes on the people. And we're gonna talk about the people here soon. So I don't recommend running out and starting now. Hey guys, what Brad said, we're gonna shut the place down for an hour, go do some cool improvements. Ease into it with what we're gonna talk about coming up next. You gotta build some culture. Right now, you have a culture. Whatever it is, good, bad, ugly, whatever's, here it is. Whatever's happening now at your factory while you're here is your culture. When you're there, kind of sort of the culture because you're watching. So we want to start building a culture. How do we do that? You got to teach people. You got to train people. I don't know why we think it's such a good idea to tell our kids to go to school. And then what happens when we become adults? Why is school such a bad idea now? It's not. We just think it is. So really, really critical to start training your people. Now, you can do in-house training. This is my buddy Will from Windmill Cabinets, crazy awesome lean thinker. You can teach your people. You can hire someone or whatever to teach your people. Like, get that training. You will not go wrong investing in training, period. And there's lots of cool, creative ways to do it. We'll recommend doing it in the morning meeting, which is next, I believe. So creating a morning meeting along with training, this is your platform now to do the training. You have whatever you want to set aside. We do 30 minutes, but I say ease into it a little bit at a time. And whatever you're comfortable with, just whatever you do, don't make the number one mistake every company makes in a meeting, and they talk about work. No one wants to talk about work. It's not fun, it's not educational, it's not motivational. If you can't remember where you left off yesterday, you've got bigger problems than needing to talk about it in front of everyone at a morning meeting. So make it fun and educational. And this is a picture of stretching. Put in some stretching. The morning meeting is an amazing break from I just left my personal life to I'm now transitioning into my work day. And if you are having a horrible day, a horrible morning, and you're coming into the factory, and you're allowed to hit the clock and go right to your workstation, that's your day right there. Your whole day is gonna be like that. Or if you come into the factory and you have to stop for 15, 20, 30, whatever minutes and communicate with the people around you, and in our meetings, we do gratefuls, we give out rock stars, we watch motivational videos, we watch lean videos, we do training, and then we do stretching. You're a different person coming out of that. You can't bring that with you. So there's some value in just getting that break before you go and start your day. So creating that culture starts with training, morning meetings, combine them together. Eliminate stupid work. This should be number two is coming up, or three. What are we at? What number are we at? Three, good, okay, I'm on track. So we wanna eliminate stupid work. Now, no work is stupid. We have to get it done, and probably I'll get in trouble for bad words, I don't know. But I look at some stuff that's going on and I'm just like, what are we doing? We're asking our customers to pay for us to look for tools. Like, if you were buying a kitchen and they were the exact same kitchen, and someone's like, this one's 50,000, this one's 75,000, but they're the same, and you're the customer and you're trying to make that decision, and the sales guy's explaining to you, oh, no. The $75,000 kitchen, it's a good value. Those people are looking for their tools all day long. You know, they're fighting amongst each other. They're spending their time in a disgusting bathroom. It takes them 5 minutes longer to get, because they have to squat and not do anything. Like, we're asking our customers to pay for all of this. This is, when, as manufacturers, we're like, oh yeah, he's just looking for a screwdriver. But as a customer, we would shut it down instantly. We'd be like, I am not paying for that. So we have to stop the stupid work. And how we do that is very smart. First, we start S-ing. Step three, write this down. Start S-ing. By the textbook, it's five S's. If you've heard of it, Toyota has the five S's. So I dumb it down to three. I never forget it. Sweep, sort, standardize. So we make time in the morning to sweep, sort, and standardize everything in our factory all the time. And that's what we're doing during the improvement time, is we're cleaning up, we're sorting out our mess, and we're standardizing it. And this can start at a low level with just tools, with just your work area, just keeping things tidy, but it goes way, 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 way deeper psychologically when this stuff starts happening. Sooner or later, the low-hanging fruit is gone, and now you actually have to go improve the process, and you have to standardize the process, and you have to start really thinking about flow and all, like, stuff we're not even talking about today. But this is step one. Start S-ing. Sweep, sort, standardize. Google it. There's a million videos on it. Paul Akers has videos. We have videos. If you're not sure how to get it going, come see us. Lynn will answer all of your questions. So this is kind of like before someone started S-ing in their factory, and then this is the after. And all of this is just happening during that improvement time. So we all think like, oh, Brad's a lunatic because he shuts his factory down for an hour a day. Not, I am a lunatic, okay, but I'm not that crazy in that they're doing it anyway. So they're gonna build a little something, they're gonna see, they're gonna clean it up, they're gonna be filling around, like, just front end load it. So in the morning, we're S-ing. If I catch someone in my factory working, I'll be pissed. But also after that time, if I catch them S-ing, I'll be pissed. So we're just front end loading all of that stuff. And this is kind of like the stuff that people come up with. They're creative geniuses. You just gotta let them go. Give them the tools. The other step number four is Kanban. Who's heard of Kanban before? Half, okay. Cool, Charlotte puts up. Good timing. Everybody welcome the wonderful and beautiful Charlotte, my assistant. Thank you for joining us. Why don't you go ahead and hand out some Kanban cards while I explain how this works? So a Kanban system is a card system to control your inventory. And probably some of you have computers that you think are controlling your inventory, and then probably you fight with those computers, and then probably you shut down for once a day to count all the stuff in your factory to make your computer accurate again. I'm not a big fan of that. And Toyota has been so kind as to just show us how to do it with simple laminated cards. Never run out of anything again. Never overpurchase anything again. Never make a purchasing mistake ever again. Does that sound half decent? It does. It's amazing. So it's a system based on cards. It's a two-bin system. And basically you put half your stuff in one, half your stuff in another with the card in the second bin. When it comes forward, you pull the card. The card goes to your purchasing people. They have QR codes on them. They scan it like at the grocery store, boop, and then they send it back out to the shop. And it's the card cycling around that control your inventory. And you never have to count it because you set the quantity on your Kanban card. So you know it's between zero and whatever. I buy 100 drawer slides, so I have between zero and 100 drawer slides at all times. I don't care if I have 75 or 25 or 50, but they cycle through at the exact rate of consumption. So you just stop running out of everything. Now, I highly recommend, you know, talking to us about this. Like, so we have a Kanban rack set up in our booth with two bins with chocolate. So it's really tempting to come and figure out how that works, and we can show you exactly how it works. But I don't recommend saying, oh yeah, great, I heard about it. Brad said I'm gonna run this Kanban system and I'm gonna make all the cards. I'm so excited about it. You might have a whole, you got some learning to do here. So we always say, start in the bathroom. Put your toilet paper on Kanban cards, put your cleaning supplies on Kanban cards, put paper towels on it. Like, manage your bathroom first. And when you get your bathroom figured out, now start branching out. You know, it's way less critical to run out of Windex than it is to run out of drawer slides. So you don't want to run that risk. Probably your break rooms too. So we do bathroom, break room, and if you have a big office, maybe not, but if you have a small office, cabinet or whatever, do that too. So get good at this stuff with pens and pencils that are not going to bankrupt you. Don't go buy your servo motors on a Kanban system just yet. So it may seem trivial. This is probably the single most powerful thing that we've done at our factory to alleviate stupid work. People running around, like, think about what it costs to run out of anything. Screws. I ran out of screws today. Okay, I'll go to the store. I'll get screws. You have someone driving. So the $75,000 kitchen, the good thing is your sales rep will be able to say, don't worry, these guys go get screws one at a time at the hardware store. That's why your kitchen's so expensive. So running out of stuff is just, when that goes away and the thinking goes away, so all of the thought is put into the card and then anyone can do the purchasing. If your purchasing person is not there that day, you just scan it or the info, you call the vendor and you're getting the exact right supplies that the purchasing person would have got. And now that person's freed up to use their brain on the more critical stuff, the custom hardware, the thinking that they need to do in their job. We're bogging them down with trivial stuff. And then once you see it working, you're gonna be like, whoa, this is insane. Like, it's so good. We have thousands of Kanban cards. We don't buy anything without a Kanban card anymore. Okay, next one. Step five, create standard work. This is the thing that everybody fights, nobody wants to do, and the lovely Charlotte will hand out some more SOPs to give you an idea of what they should look like. We all kind of put this off, but think of how long it takes to teach someone how to do something. Usually we explain it, and then the next day we explain it again, and the next day we explain it again and again until the person gets it. This is number one craziest way to train anybody, but it's how we all do it. You create standard work, and all of a sudden the trainee has a reference that they can use the next day and go back and remind themselves, oh, okay, I don't need to go bug that person, I remember. So these serve as a wonderful reminder, and on tasks that you don't maybe do every single day, you can refer to the SOP and you don't have to get retaught that every 3 months or whatever. The trick with these and where people go wrong is we've probably all at some point created a standard, this big long type page of something that nobody will ever read, ever, ever. Not even when they're stuck. How many of us get IKEA furniture and we throw out the instructions? Like, we will never read this stuff. So the key is big picture, little writing. The picture does the talking, and then the writing just kind of like reminds you of what you need to do. Very critical. As soon as you see a type page, it's over. I won't even read a text message that's half of my screen. I look at it, and I'm like, forget it. They'll message me later with a shorter sentence. So this is the attention span you're getting, and people are not any different when it comes to their work. So we want to keep them concise with pictures. Now, the kicker here with SOPs is you will get them wrong. Count on making 10 for every one you think you're making, because you will forget that little step. The one you have, is that the robot one? Yeah. So we're making that SOP just as like a demo so people could run our machine without us being there. And I realized, oh no, I forgot a step. That's the problem. If we're creating this stuff in like a Word document or Excel or something, you have to have a fast way to create it and edit it, or else it's gonna be too frustrating. No one will be like, I just spent 4 hours on that and now I have to redo it. You need a quick way. Come see us, we help you. Easy peasy. So those are the five things that you need to be doing immediately to get your lean journey off on the right foot. So, I mean, you saw a snapshot of what these companies were doing. You saw some morning meetings, you saw some stretching, you saw some 3Sing with all of their improvements. And just imagine that this is going on in these companies every single day by every single person. It is only a matter of time until you are the best, period. Lean thinking, studying, learning, all of this stuff is for 2% of the world. And I am thrilled to see that. Like, look how many of us are here. This is fantastic. But how many people came to the show? 8,000 people? I don't know. How many are here? 50? So your competitors are all out there, and you're here. There's only a handful of people that are going to win in that equation, and I'll pick you guys all day long. So give yourself a big round of applause for being here. Thank you very much for your time.